The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Welcome to New Hope Presbyterian Church. Whether you're here with us in person or watching our live stream, I'm so glad you chose to worship with us today, this third Sunday in Lent. I am Pastor Colleen Cook. Our liturgist this month is Rebecca Tucker. Our organist is Gary Nierhoff. I'd like to read you New Hope's statement of welcome and inclusion. Welcome. Recognizing the great diversity in which God created humankind, we welcome you as God's own in body and soul, young, old, or somewhere in between. You may live alone, as a couple, or within a family. You may identify with different racial and ethnic groups. You may come with your own sexual identity and gender expressions. You may have unique physical or mental abilities, and you may be firm in your faith or seeking your path. You are welcome here. Our COVID-19 task force met on Friday, and after reviewing the data about case numbers, positivity rate, and hospitalizations, decided to make some changes in our protocols. We have already begun to sing. Next week, we are making wearing masks optional. Please keep in mind that there are many individuals for whom continuing to mask makes sense, and please do not ask them to unmask. We have removed the tape from every other pew, but remind you that some social distancing still makes sense, especially when you're not wearing a mask, and we'll continue to pass the peace in place by waving for now. For our next communion, which will be Maundy Thursday, due to the fact that I will be out of town on April 3rd, we will reintroduce communion by intinction. The prepackaged communion elements will still be available if you're more comfortable with them. But we will return to a process where servers will sanitize their hands before serving and will hand you a chunk of bread and outstretched hands, and you will dip it in the juice without letting your fingers touch the juice. The task force wants to remind you that the situation could change quickly if new variants arise, and we will be nimble and reintroduce masking, et cetera, as necessary. But it is good news that we're doing so well in our community right now.
I have a few more announcements. You're invited, as always, to attend our Spanish language service this afternoon at 1:30 to share hospitality and to get to know our new friends. First Presbyterian Church is holding a service of prayer for Ukraine at 5 this evening, and they've invited us to come. We do not have youth group this afternoon, but we will meet in person next week. Please rise in body or spirit as God calls us to worship. Everyone who thirsts,
come to the waters, seek the Lord, repent and return so that you may live.
All who are hungry for righteousness,
come to the waters, seek the Lord, repent and return so that you may live.
All who need the help of God,
come to the waters, seek the Lord, repent and return so that you may live.
Please be seated.
The scriptures call us to turn from sinful ways and return to God, who offers mercy and pardon. Trusting in that mercy, let us call upon God who is near. Read with me the prayer of confession printed in your bulletin and then confess silently. Holy God, we confess that we have grown complacent in our response to you. You set before us a rich feast of blessing, but we are drawn to lesser things that cannot satisfy. You call us to attend to urgent needs in the world, but we indulge our own desires. Our ways are not your ways. Our thoughts do not ascend to your thoughts. Forgive us when we fall short of your claim upon our lives. Disturb our complacency and quicken our desire for a more fruitful life. Be patient, we pray, as we amend who we are in the hope of becoming who you intend us to be. We ask this in the name of our Savior, your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, God's love is sure and steadfast, always providing a way out, a way through, a way back to God. Thanks be to God. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Forgiveness reconciles us to God. Let us also be reconciled to one another through the passing of the peace. We'll wave from our seats for now and notice who is missing that we might call during the week to share the peace of Christ. Beloved ones, the peace of Christ be with you.
Please join me in a prayer for illumination. We seek you in your word, O God, as though we are searching for water in a dry and weary land. By the power of your Holy Spirit, may this word be to us a rich feast, satisfying the soul. Then with our mouths we will praise you, and with our lives we will bless you, our host and our hope. Our first scripture reading is from Psalms chapter 63, verses 1 through 8. Listen for a word from the Lord. O God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory, because your steadfast love is better than life. My lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands and call on your name. My soul is satisfied as with a rich feast, and my mouth praises you with joyful lips. When I think of you on my bed and meditate on you in the watches of the night. For you have been my help, and in the shadow of your wings I sing for joy. My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Now I'd like to talk to the children and youth for just a minute. Have you ever tried to grow something? We're going to read a story about a fig tree that grew but never grew any figs. How disappointing to plant and expect delicious, juicy fruit and never get any. In the story, there is a gardener who knows some ways to make the fig tree grow, but it involves some things that aren't all that pleasant: digging around the roots to aerate the soil, and putting manure on the roots. Sometimes we are like fig trees, growing but with no fruit, and we need God to change the soil we are in by adding some smelly old manure, stuff that changes the way we act in the world and helps us develop the fruits of the Spirit, like peace, gentleness, and kindness. God can help us grow those things, but sometimes the way to them is hard. Let's pray to bear fruit, even when it is hard. Pray with me. Dear God, change our soils to make us trees that have fruit to share with the world, righteousness, peace, joy, kindness, and gentleness. Thank you, God. Amen. Today's second scripture is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 13, verses 1 through 9. Listen for a word from the Lord. At that very time, there were some present who told him about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. He asked them, "Do you think that because these Galileans suffered in this way, they were worse sinners than all other Galileans?" "No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did." Or those 18 who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think they were worse offenders than all the others living in Jerusalem? "No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish just as they did." Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for fruit on it and found none. So he said to the gardener, "See here, for 3 years I have come looking for fruit on this fig tree, and still I find none. Cut it down. Why should it be wasting the soil?" He replied, "Sir, let it alone for one more year until I dig around it and put manure on it. If it bears fruit next year, well and good. But if not, you can cut it down." The word of the Lord. Doom scrolling. It's one of Merriam-Webster's words we're watching, rising in popular use but not yet meeting the criteria for entry into the dictionary. It's a new word associated with the pandemic, but generally referring to the tendency to keep consuming news, especially when the news is bad, disheartening, dystopian, depressing. Maybe you've done it, continuing to read the news feed on your phone and descending ever deeper into bad news, doom scrolling. Because there's plenty of bad news, isn't there? From news of new coronavirus variants, to the death of innocents in the war in Ukraine, to shootings right here in Columbus. It can be hard to draw the line between being well-informed and being paralyzed by news of humanity's inhumanity and nature's vagaries. Jesus' followers didn't have smartphones, but they were capable of collecting bad news, rehashing it, and commiserating over it, looking for patterns and who was to blame. They brought Jesus one such item. "Lord, did you hear this awful thing? Pilate killed some Galileans and mixed their blood with their sacrifices." It was a scandalous story, evoking pity as well as raising nationalist hackles and anger at the empire. Jesus seized the opportunity to teach and perhaps to interrupt some bad theology. "Do you think that because these Galileans suffered in this way, they were worse sinners than all other Galileans?" No. There is a substantial thread of the Bible that suggests that humans do always get what they deserve. Read in Deuteronomy or Proverbs, for example. But Jesus refutes this. No, bad things do happen to good people. Those Galileans who were killed were no worse sinners than all other Galileans. But here comes the tricky part. Next he says, "But unless you repent, you will all perish as they did." Jesus scrolls down to another item recently on their minds, a story without a villain, unless the villain is shoddy construction. Or those 18 who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them. Do you think that they were worse offenders than all others living in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish just as they did. What does it mean to repent? The Greek word is metanoia, literally to change one's mind. But mind in the parlance of the day meant something more like heart. So repenting is having a change of heart. Jesus wants his listeners to do a 180 turn in thinking and feeling and believing and acting, to repent. Why? According to him, it won't prevent a senseless killing. The Galileans who were killed by Pilate were no worse sinners than the Galileans who were not killed. Towers can fall on the just and the unjust. But Jesus seems to be telling his followers that it is time to change their lives for a more urgent reason than saving their earthly lives. He seems to be warning of judgment coming, of time running out, a cosmic limit to our foolishness and to the randomness of human suffering. Repent, or you will perish as they did. And yet, Jesus follows it up with a parable. A story of a fig tree that was just taking up space in the vineyard, unfruitful, barren. The absentee landlord comes to visit and notices the tree. It has not borne for 3 years. He knows his acreage is valuable. He should be making use of his resources for fruit he can sell and earn a profit on. Why allow the fig tree to take up valuable real estate? The gardener employed by the landowner asks for forbearance on the part of the fig tree. Let me work on it. Let me turn the soil and loosen the rocky, packed clods around the roots and add nourishment, good manure. Let me give this barren tree one more chance, one more year. If I give it lots of attention and care and it still bears no figs, well and good, cut it down. And so ends the parable. We never find out whether the good care and the earthy nutrients of the manure made any difference. We are left to ponder second chances and to hope for our own. The Jesus who warns, repent or perish, the time is nigh, is the same Jesus who tells the story of grace and second chances. We are left to imagine ourselves as fig trees, dry and fruitless ones, who through no action of our own are afforded one more chance for figs, to be cared for and worked on and fertilized. The gardener does not see us as simply taking up valuable space. The gardener sees our potential and thinks we are worth a bit of digging and manure, a humble turnaround. Repentance not of our own will and dogged good works, but the work of a Savior. Abigail Kocher said this: the gospel of the second chance is not about what we can do to redeem ourselves or how we can put right our wrongs. It is about letting God bring forth fruit from our lives that we could never have produced on our own. Somehow, we are deemed worthy of a second chance, a few scoops of manure, loosening the dirt at our roots. We have one more chance at growing figs, of being fruitful, swelling with sweetness and fruity aroma. We never hear the end of the parable, the outcome. Did the tree bear? Was it spared when the landowner returned the next year? We don't know. What of free will and the fig tree's efforts? Can the fig tree pick itself up and go to a spot in the vineyard with better sunlight, richer soil? Can it repent and turn itself around? Jesus said, repent or perish, and then followed up with this, a story of a tree that seemed content to put forth leaves but no fruit, chosen by the gardener to be spared and showered with attention. Repentance in this story seems less about effort at self-improvement than surrender to a dose of humbling manure and welcoming the efforts of the master gardener. In the end, it is always about grace. Always. The season of Lent is one of repentance, of fasting and giving alms and doing good. But let's admit we're as powerless as that fig tree to fertilize ourselves. Thanks be to God for the gardeners in our lives, those who offer us grace and rich manure. Thanks be to God for second chances. Amen.
Please rise in body or spirit as we sing hymn number 92, Beneath the Cross of Jesus.
Thank you.
remain standing as we say what we believe using the Westminster Shorter Catechism. What is the first commandment?
The first commandment is, thou shalt have no other gods before me.
What is required in the first commandment?
The first commandment requires us to know and acknowledge God, the only Lord God, and our God, and to worship and glorify Him accordingly.
What is forbidden in the first commandment? What are we specifically taught by these words, before me, in the first commandment?
These words, before me, in the first commandment, teach us that God sees all things, takes notice of, and is much displeased with him, since we have any other God.
Please be seated.
If you have been doom scrolling, you know of many needs for prayer. We turn our hearts toward the people of Ukraine yet again, suffering through war. We turn our hearts toward those in our own community who are ill, who are suffering, who are grieving. We thank you, O Lord, and we offer you these prayers. Creator of all that was and is and shall be, you have brought us beneath your wings and cheered our fledging feats of flight. You have cared for our tender stems and watered our deepening roots. We turn to you and call upon your holy name. In your mercy, O God, we give thanks for the wonder of your creation, and we pray your forgiveness for the ways we have laid waste to it. We offer praise for its awesome beauty, and we share our concerns for the harm that it has endured. In your mercy, O God, we give thanks for the fruits of hope and faithfulness we have witnessed this week, and we pray for blessing on those who have shown those fruits to us. In your mercy, O God. We take a moment in silence to repent of our failures this week, when we have turned away from others, spoken harsh and unforgiving words, refused to share with those in need, or kept others from feeling your grace. In your mercy, O God, we thank you for your church, both for this community and your people in all places, that we can tend to one another, raise our wings to give harbor, and challenge each other to be our best selves. May we be your hands and feet in the world, stooping to water and to shape, scattering your love and grace like so many seeds. In your mercy, O God, may the light of Christ shine upon us and help us to grow. Amen. And now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us in the words or language closest to your heart. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You may contribute to the life and work of New Hope by placing your tithes, offerings, and pledges in the collection plates at the rear of the sanctuary. You may also mail them to the church office or give online on our website. The QR code in your bulletin will take you straight there. Let's bless this offering. God of wilderness and promised land, in days of want and in days of plenty, you have been with us. By these gifts we now share, may others know of your providence and care. Send us not only our offerings, but our very selves, to console and comfort, to lift up and reach out, to listen and sit beside your children everywhere at the one table you have set. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please rise in body or spirit as we sing the doxology.
God ground us, the love of Christ take root in us, and the Holy Spirit grow in us, that we may be ready for the coming of the kingdom. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.